Thank you, Brother Raymond. Actually, Brother Raymond and myself go back a long way. We were classmates in Standard 1. I don't know if you remember. Way back. Praise God. God is good. Amen? Hallelujah. I trust most of y'all who went out for a holiday with your family during this school break, you would have come back refreshed. Amen? Yes, some haven't come back, I think. Praise the Lord. Now, this morning, we are going to continue on the series of the attack of the heart. Not heart attack, attack of the heart. And we have had already Pastor Calvin come and speak about pride. And we had Pastor Nikki come and speak about anger. And we had Pastor Sue speak about what? Lust. Okay? And today we're going to continue with this series. It works, praise the Lord, on unforgiveness, okay? So before we go any further, let's commit this time to the Lord. Heavenly Father, we want to thank you for this beautiful morning that you have created, that we can come and worship you as a family. And right now, Lord, even as I share your word, I just pray that your Holy Spirit will anoint me, that every word I speak, Lord, will be an encouragement of Father, and will stir our faith to God. To walk closer to you, Lord. In Jesus' name we ask and give thanks. Amen. Hallelujah. I'd like to thank, all those who at the pre-service prayer prayed for me. And over the past few days, some people got to know that I'm preaching this morning and they said, we are praying for you, brother. And, you know, there's such an encouragement. Huh? And those days, sometimes people don't know who is going to preach until you come here on Sunday. Nowadays, it's on Facebook. So you can't run. Everybody seems to know. Praise the Lord. So, this morning, as we talk about unforgiveness, you know, unforgiveness is the single most popular poison that the enemy can use against God's people. And it is one of the deadliest poisons a person can take spiritually. And it can cause anything from mental depression to health problems such as stomach ulcers, cancers, and arthritis. Okay? And this is not just my saying. There is a lot of research that has gone into this. Okay? And, all of us have gone through an experience whereby we harbored some unforgiveness. Am I right? Wow. You're all so good. Nobody had unforgiveness before. Am I right? Yes. Okay. So, oftentimes when we have suffered injustice and when we have been a victim of abuse, we have been cheated or even wrongly accused, it becomes very difficult for us to forgive those who have wronged us. Amen? It becomes very difficult for us to forgive because we are human beings. And we get angry very quickly. And sometimes, if we do not control our anger and we don't forgive somebody quickly, it can result in tragedies. Just a few days ago, along our Kajang KL Seremban Highway, there were two cars that had a small accident. And the two drivers came out and they were fighting with each other near the Sungai Besi toll. How many of you read that story? Okay? And the public came and separated the two drivers, you know, so they got back onto their cars and they continued to drive southwards and they began to tailgate each other. Okay? And they ended up cornering each other in Bangi. One guy got down with a baseball bat. The other guy saw and panicked and he accelerated the car, pinned the guy to the divider, and the guy died. They reported in Kajang police station. Just here, all right? Just a moment of anger and unforgiveness can lead to tragedy. Many people are very stressed up these days. Very stressed up these days, and we get angry over the slightest thing. And sometimes this anger is because of things that we believe are justifiable to be angry. Am I right? Yeah? Most of the time, that's the case. We believe that we have a right to be angry because that person did wrong. How can you expect me to forgive him? Do you know what he did to me? Do you know? Are you in my shoes? People will say. Unless you are in my shoes, you will know. How can I even forgive him? You have no idea what he has done. Do you know how many times he has done this against me? These are all the kind of things that we would justify. Why we need to harbor unforgiveness. It is so difficult to forgive one another. And despite clear instructions from the Bible, friendships, families, marriages, ministries, and lives are being broken up at a frightening rate. People are turning to divorce, crime, drugs, violence, and gangs, trying to stop their personal pain. Why is all this happening? Why are we going through so much of trouble? Counselors and psychiatrists have discovered a very common thread: unforgiveness and bitter hearts. Sons and daughters are bitter against absent fathers or negligent mothers. Wives are bitter against abusive husbands. Fathers are bitter against their own abusive fathers, turning their rage against their own families. Women are bitter against men, and children are bitter against their parents. Everyone is holding unforgiveness against those who have hurt them. And the resulting bitterness of heart is eating them up inside. And this is a common thread that we are seeing today. Many families are experiencing a lot of hardships because of unforgiveness. Even Christian homes. Parents are having it difficult to communicate with the children. Children cannot communicate with the parents. Children are angry with the parents for various reasons that they can justify. Parents are angry with the children, cannot forgive, because of certain things that were done. And because of that, there is a lot of strife. There is a lot of stress in the family. And in this kind of environment where there is a lot of stress, unforgiveness, you know who thrives? Sorry? The devil thrives in this kind of environment. He loves it. Okay? The more there is this kind of a tense environment where family members don't speak to each other, he thrives. His voice becomes very loud in our lives if we are not careful. So man has been struggling with this issue of unforgiveness for centuries. And one day when Jesus was with his disciples, Peter came up to him with a question. Sorry, let's back that up. Yes. Sorry. Can you back it up from me from the other back? Can you go backwards, please? Yeah, thank you. No, sorry, Eddie, I was told to point it this way. Apparently, there's a receiver here. Okay, doesn't matter, as long as it works. So, let's turn to Matthew chapter 18, verse 21 to 35, the parable of the unmerciful servant. Okay, we all know this parable, but let's read it together this morning, all right? Matthew chapter 18. Matthew chapter 18, verse 21 onwards. Then Peter came to Jesus and asked, "Lord, how many times shall I forgive my brother when he sins against me? Up to 7 times? Jesus answered, "I tell you, not 7 times, but 77 times. Therefore, the kingdom of heaven is like a king who wanted to settle accounts with his servants. As he began the settlement, a man who owed him 10,000 talents was brought to him. Since he was not able to pay, the master ordered that he and his wife and his children and all that he had be sold to repay the debt. The servant fell on his knees before him. 'Be patient with me,' he begged, 'and I will pay back everything.' The servant's master took pity on him, canceled the debt, and let him go. But when that servant went out, he found one of his fellow servants who owed him 100 denarii. He grabbed him and began to choke him. "Pay back what you owe me," he demanded. His fellow servant fell to his knees and begged him, "Be patient with me, and I will pay you back." But he refused. Instead, he went off and had the man thrown into prison until he could pay the debt. Verse 31. When the other servants saw what had happened, they were greatly distressed and went and told their master everything that had happened. Then the master called the servant in. "You wicked servant," he said, "I cancel all that debt of yours because you begged me to. Shouldn't you have had mercy on your fellow servant just as I had on you?" In anger, his master turned him over to the jailers to be tortured until he should pay back all he owed. "This is how my heavenly Father will treat each of you unless you forgive your brother from your heart." You know, when we read this scripture, some people like to debate on the non-essentials. So 70 times 7, 77, is it 77? Or is it 70 times 7, which is 490? You know, some people like to discuss on these non-essentials. The main point Jesus Christ was saying is not 490 times or 77 times, but as many times as possible. Am I right? Yeah? But you know, sometimes you'll meet people who like to thrive on this. Oh, it's a 10,000 talents is equivalent to how much in Malaysian ringgit? Oh, it's, 10,000. I think it's about a few million. What about 100 denarii? You know? Oh, I think it's about this amount and that. Basically, Jesus Christ was trying to draw a parallel. 10,000 talents is a lot of money, something that man could not pay. Whereas, 100 denarii is a very small amount compared to that 110,000 talents. Are you with me? So let's not get caught up by all those little things. Let's come to the crux of the whole parable. The crux of the parable is this. Jesus Christ said that master forgive that man when he came and pleaded with him. Am I right? He owed him such a big amount of money and he pleaded with him and the master kindly forgave that man. And then that man goes and finds somebody else who owed him a small amount of money. And that person pleaded with him. But this time, this man did not forgive him and had him thrown into prison. So when the master found out what this man had did, he had this man come back and thrown into prison until he settled his debt. But we will look into this a little bit more detail, okay? And that is the crux of the matter. In other words, Jesus Christ is trying to say that God forgave us all our sins. Amen? When we believed what Jesus Christ did on the cross for us, he forgave us of all our sins. And God expects us to forgive one another likewise. Am I right? And it says here, okay, it says here in verse 35, "This is how my heavenly Father will treat each of you unless you forgive your brother from your heart." So just like how we receive forgiveness from God, we need to forgive one another from our heart. Sometimes when people ask for forgiveness, it's not genuine. Hey, forgive me, okay, shake hand, okay. Yeah, forgive you, it's all right, you know. But inside, still, you know. That is why the Bible says specifically, you must forgive from where? From the heart. Shake hand, not enough. It must be a genuine forgiveness. It is very, very important. And we as human beings, like people in the old days, we are often very critical of people who do things that are straight away we can categorize as sin. People who murder, people who commit robbery. Oh, he did. You know, he committed adultery. Oh, he committed fraud. Oh, no. You know how many millions of dollars he siphoned from the company? Very obvious things we are very quick to address. But you know, we talk about attack of the heart. These things cannot be seen properly sometimes. Pride, lust, anger, Can you see visibly? Sometimes can, but most of the time it's inside. Same thing with forgiveness, unforgiveness. Unforgiveness is a big, big issue. It is a real big issue in many circles, in many Christian families. Today, divorce has crept into the church. How sad. How sad when couples come to the altar and say, for better, for worse, for richer, for poorer, in sickness and in health, till death do us part. And then 2 years later, irreconcilable differences. They file for divorce. That is sad. Is that God's plan? Are Christian couples and families exempt from trials and difficulties? No. But the Word of God has the answer. Amen? The Word of God has the answer. And we're going to look at that. We're going to look at that shortly. Let's move on. Melody, I'm going to need your help to scroll that to the next slide. Can you please? Okay, we're going to look now at the consequences of unforgiveness. Okay, God will not forgive us our sins. In Matthew chapter 6, verse 14 and 15. Yeah. And also in Mark 11, 25 and 26. Can you please move it along? So, as in this parable, you can see it says in verse 35, this is how my heavenly Father will treat each of you unless you forgive your brother from your heart. Let's look at Mark chapter 11, verse 25 and 26. And when you stand praying, if you hold anything against anyone, forgive him so that your Father in heaven may forgive you your sins. Okay? So, in order for us to receive forgiveness, we need also to forgive one another. Now, when we accepted Jesus Christ as our personal Savior, God forgave us of all our sins. Amen? Amen? Yeah? He gave us a clean slate. But from that point onwards, does it mean that we don't sin? Does it mean that we don't sin? Whether you like it or not, you tend to sin from time to time. Am I right? Sometimes not in your actions, but in your thoughts, in your words, we can sin because we are still on earth. But Jesus Christ says, I don't know why the projector is not working, but doesn't matter. I'm not going to blame it on the devil. Can you recite the Lord's Prayer? Let's recite it together. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Now in that, the Lord's Prayer, there's one thing that he emphasizes. Am I right? What does he emphasize? And forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. In some translations it says, we forgive our sins as we have forgiven those who have sinned against us. In other words, it is a prerequisite. The Lord's Prayer was meant to be a daily prayer. Am I right? It's a sample daily prayer. Am I right? I'm not just saying that you should memorize it and quote it simply without knowing what it means, but it's meant to be a daily prayer. In other words, we need to check our lives daily and bring our sins that we may have committed during the day to the Lord and ask God for forgiveness. You remember a time when Jesus Christ, he took a towel and he went and he washed his disciples' feet? You remember that? Yeah? And when he came to Peter, what happened? Peter said, no, you can't. Master, you can't wash my feet. But then Jesus Christ said, you won't have a part with me if I don't do that. And then what did Peter say? Oh, wash my whole body. This guy a bit extreme. He said, wash my whole body. And what did Jesus Christ respond? He said, your whole body is clean. Your feet is dirty. I need to wash your feet only. You know, when we accepted the Lord as our personal Savior, He forgave us of all our sins. It's like we had a full bath. Our whole body is clean. Am I right? But daily as we go through life, as we walk around, our feet gets dirty. You know what I mean? Yeah? We sin in our thoughts, in our words, in our actions, every day. So we need to come to the Lord and ask God to forgive us. Huh? But we thank God. 1 John 1:9, it says, if we confess our sins, He is faithful and just to forgive us and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Amen? That's the word of God. Huh? So, praise the Lord. It is back. So Melody will help me to scroll that. Can we move to the next verse, please? Mark 6, verse 14 and 15. For if you forgive other people when they sin against you, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. But if you do not forgive others their sins, your Father will not forgive your sins. Can you, next slide, please? And when you stand praying, if you hold anything against anyone, forgive them so that your Father in heaven may forgive you your sins. You see, there are many verses that keep talking about this, about how we need to forgive so that our sins are also forgiven. Can you scroll to the next slide, please? So, the first point I was saying is, the consequences of unforgiveness is that our sins will not be forgiven. The second point is, God will hand us over to the tormentors. Now, in the parable of the unmerciful, in the parable of the unmerciful servant just now, you would see towards the end, when that person was recalled, and the master said, send him to the tormentors. Huh? In some versions it says send him to the jailers, or some versions it says send him to the torturers. If we harbor unforgiveness, we open a door for demonic spirits to torment us. All right? Can you, next point, please? Matthew chapter 18, verse 33 to 35. Should you not also have had compassion on your fellow servant, just as I had pity on you? And his master was angry and delivered him to the torturers or tormentors until he should pay all that was due to him. So my heavenly Father also will do to you if each of you from his heart does not forgive his brother his trespasses or sins. In other words, if we harbor unforgiveness, we open the door for the torturers to come in. Next slide, please. As a result, many Christians are, next point, being tormented. Now, what do I mean by being tormented? You know, many years ago, I had a personal experience, okay? Somebody accused me of something that I didn't do. And I was very bitter and hurt and angry with that person. And you know what happened? Now I know that I was handed over to the tormentors, or I had opened the door for the tormentors to come in. Every morning, 4:30 in the morning, I would get up and all those things that person accused me would replay in my mind. You know, it was like every sentences that was said, it would just replay in my mind again and again, and anger would just come up. What time? 4:30, 5 o'clock in the morning. And I turn this side, my wife is found asleep. And I'm tossing and turning. I said, what's happening to me? And this did not happen for one day or two days. It went on for several days. And one day I woke my wife up and said, Sue, you got to pray over me. This thing is affecting me. And she got up and she prayed. Well, it still didn't go away. And I prayed to the Lord. I said, Lord, what's happening? You know? And the Lord said, you need to forgive that person. I said, okay. All right. So I began to release that person in prayer. And I began to bless that person. The Lord told me, bless that person and his family. You know? And I began to do that. As I began to do that, that release came. I got back my sleep. Those voices were not replaying. You know? And I tell you, when those voices come and hit you in the morning, you know that you are being tormented. You know, it's not something very casual. You know, it's like bombarding your mind. That's how bad it was. So I was set free from that. And I know some of us can be harboring certain anger, unforgiveness, and you might be in a similar position. Let me encourage you this morning. Release it to the Lord. Forgive that person. Ask the Holy Spirit. We'll talk about that a little bit later on how we need to do this. Ask the Holy Spirit to help you. Bless that person, and you will find a release. We need to address this issue. Don't sweep it under the carpet. Unforgiveness, you must not sweep it under the carpet. It is like a poison, you know. You know what is arsenic? Yeah? Yeah. Arsenic poison, it actually comes from the ground. But some people use that to poison other people. Somebody said, some theory said that Napoleon Bonaparte, when he was exiled, they put a small portion of arsenic into his wine every day and slowly killed him. Somebody said, I don't know how far it's true. But it kills you slowly from the inside because of what you take. It's a kind of poison. And similarly, unforgiveness is a kind of a poison to our spirit. We need to get it out of our system. Yesterday I was at the prayer altar seminar, and Pastor Stanley, he said, it is filth. I said, yes, exactly. It is filth. If you don't get rid of it, it's like being constipated, you know. It's like being spiritually constipated. You know, is it a nice feeling? So you got all this thing, this filth that needs to come out of your body, but it remains in you. You need to get it out. If not, it becomes toxic. Am I right? Similarly, in the spirit realm, we need to let it go, like the Frozen song. We need to let it go, brothers and sisters. Well, the points went ahead of me. Second point is unforgiveness can lead to physical ailments. Okay? Unforgiveness can lead to physical ailments. John Hopkins School of Medicine said this: whether it's a simple spat with your spouse or a long-held resentment toward a family member or friend, unresolved conflict can go deeper than you may realize. It may be affecting your physical health. The good news, studies have found that the act of forgiveness can reap huge rewards for your health, lowering the risk of heart attack, improving cholesterol levels and sleep, and reducing pain, blood pressure, and levels of anxiety, depression, and stress. Other medical articles have associated unforgiveness and bitterness to stomach ulcers, cancers, and arthritis. So this John Hopkins Medical Journal, medically they are proving that unforgiveness can lead to all of this. And what is the solution they are claiming? To forgive. Where are they getting the solutions from? It's all in the Bible. It's already been there. We don't need John Hopkins to tell us that. But why I'm saying this is, even the medical people are endorsing what the Bible has told us over the past 2,000 years. Amen? Amen? We need, sometimes we tend to believe those articles more than the Bible. But it's all here. It's all here. Huh? And this morning, I want to invite somebody to come and share a short testimony. Okay? And this testimony actually pertains to being physically sick and how that plays with unforgiveness. Okay? So, the person is none other than my daughter, Cassandra. Huh? And I'm not inviting her because, you know, I want to elevate her to come and give a testimony here or something like that. But because I believe what she's going to share will resonate with some of us here and can be an encouragement. Okay? So, can I invite Cassandra to come?
Thank you. Okay, good morning, everybody. My name is Cassandra, my father's daughter. So today I'm going to share with you how unforgiveness that I had harbored affected my life, and how when I started to forgive, how I experienced this freedom. So ever since I was five years old, I started to have eczema. And for those of you who know, eczema is actually a bad stage of rashes. For me, my eczema was triggered by sweat, it was triggered by stress, and it was triggered by certain food that I took. And just to paint a bit of a picture how severe my eczema was, during stress period, like exam period, it would be very difficult for me to sleep at night because of like the itchiness, and I would bleed, and it like a whole drama would be happening in the house. And I would get it in my face sometimes, and even in school, I had a special letter in school saying that I could roll up my pants, you know, because the eczema was so bad. And because of that, in school, many of the students, it was more of Cassandra had leprosy, Cassandra had crocodile skin, you know, these kind of things. And now I look back, it's a joke, la, but you know, in that being 10, 11, 12, 13, these things, they get to you. You know, your friends tell you that you have leprosy, it's like, oh, you know, people don't want to sit with you, things like that. So it was very severe. And because of how, you know, even growing up as a Christian, when you have prayer rally or something, your parents put you right in the front, you know, pray and ask God to heal you. And that was me. Every prayer rally, I would diligently come to the front and ask God to heal me, but the healing never came. And after, I don't know, 8, 9, 10 years, everything just came together, and you think, you know, you're growing up, you feel that you can rationalize, you start to think for yourself. And I told myself, you know, I'm not going to pray anymore. You know, I prayed for, you know, 8, 9, 10 years, nothing is happening. It's not a big deal. You know, after you've had a condition for so long, you learn how to deal with the condition. You know, I can tell you the treatment for eczema like that. I know how much dose to give myself, how much medication to take, you know, how to deal with it in certain situation. It grows on you. You learn how to deal with it. And I told myself, you know, if God doesn't want to heal me, so be it. You know, maybe it's God's will for me not to be healed. And growing up as a Christian, if anybody come and tell me that, oh, I feel like it's not God's will for me to be healed, I'll be like, no, don't believe this, you know. But for me, I let myself believe that maybe, you know, it's just not God's plan for me to be healed. And so I stopped praying. At about 14, 15, I stopped praying. As you all know, about 3 years ago, I stood here and I presented that I was going to go to India. And I went to India, and you know, in our discipleship training school, there's a lot of teaching that helps you to deal with a lot of these issues. And we learn, you know, how unforgiveness can cause us to, can hinder God from healing us. And so when I heard that, like I said, you know, I stopped praying for healing. For me, it's as if, you know, it's no longer a prayer request for me. I have eczema, whether I like it and all, it's no longer on my prayer list. So I just took it as a teaching, you know, extra knowledge. And even when there were things that I had to, when, you know, altar call. They'll say, if you have any unforgiveness, now is the time to forgive. Every time I scan my heart, I feel like, I mean, generally, I'm a very happy-go-lucky person. Like, what's bothering me? Nothing really, you know? I'm angry with you today, tomorrow I'm okay. You know, there's not much happening. Or if you say some people are angry with their school teachers, not really, you know, before SPM, you'll go and salam, salam. I feel finished lah, like nothing is really, I don't harbor much, you know. But God started to reveal to me unforgiveness that I had, that I guess it's been so long, I didn't know I had it anymore, because you just, some things, you grow to just be neutral towards the situation after a while. And that unforgiveness was actually towards my father. Okay, don't get me wrong. My father's a very, very good man. He provides for our family. He never did anything wrong. He never abused us or anything like that. You don't have to worry about my father. Work finished, he's at home. He's not going. He's either in work or he's in church, okay? There's nothing you need to, like, worry about. And it was just that, you know, when you are young, you can't think, you know? Your mind is very immature. You can't think. And for me, my dad was extremely involved in, like, church and meetings and things like that. So he was always, you know, either, like I said, in the house or in church or in work. And most of the time, it was church and work. And so growing up, I was very much more connected to my mother, because my mom was a housewife. So I always clashed with Papa. He come on here, I'll be like, no, don't tell me what to do. I was like typical teenage rebellion, you know, thinking that my father was not in the house. He should not have a say in my life, you know, just typical drama, okay? So, but that was like 13, 14, 15, you know. But when I reached 16, 17, there was a turn of events in my house. My mom started to work. My father started to stay at home. So for the first 6 months, it was like, oh, your stress, full stress. My father will fetch me at the wrong gate from school, wrong tuition. We'll go for lunch. We will start nicely, how was school? And you know me, I'm very expressive. I will talk with my hands and everything. And my father will be like, what are you doing? Who is this teacher? You know, I was like, for the last, you know, 7, 8 years, my mom has been dealing with me. She knows my friend. She knows my teacher. She knows the principal, you know, and my father is now asking these basic questions. I was like, so, you know, for the first 6 months, it was back and forth arguing. But after a while, you know, again, my dad and I, we started to have this great relationship. And when I went to India, when God convicted me of all this unforgiveness that I had towards my father, I told God, what are you talking about? I have a great relationship with my father now. I can see eye to eye with my father. I can discuss what I want with my father. You know, I guess I didn't want to accept it. And then God brought up all of these issues. And he said, no, you have to, you know, release forgiveness. And that's what I did. I prayed and I asked God to forgive me of all this unforgiveness that I had towards my father, and I released forgiveness to my father. But you know, God, he's so loving. He's so he's very full on with quality control. He wanted to make sure that, you know, I genuinely forgave my father. So in our school, we have accountability leaders. So every day she will come and check, you know, what we did. So I said, yeah, today I forgave my father, yada, yada. Then she said, you know, when you forgive, take it a step further. Confess to your dad. Okay, point number one. We are Asian people. We're not going to confront our father, okay? This is not, it's just not something we do, okay? You are happy, I am happy. We'll just leave it at that. But she's like, no, you have to confess to your father and ask him to forgive you. And I said, no. I mean, these things happened when I was 5, 6 years old. It's such an embarrassment. You go now and say, Pa, forgive me, you know, that time I 5 years old got angry at you. It's like unnecessary, okay? But she was so persistent. And I said, one day I said, I'm not ready. It's not necessary. It's no need like that. And she said, no, it is the right thing to do. And she locked me up. She called my dad on Skype. She put me there. She locked me up in the room. And she said, until you finish, you don't come out. Okay, if you all know, I'm very emotional. My father and I, we are the emotional ones in the family. So I stood there and I sat down and said, yeah, hi, Pa, how are you? Okay. So he said, Shlian, talk about something. And I spelled everything out. I said, okay, I'm going to tell this, 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 and I don't want you to say anything until I finish. And it took me so long, you know, crying and crying and trying to spell everything out in detail, because I realized that I had to be obedient to God. If not, my leader was still going to come and pester me. It was just not happening. So I went into the room and I said, you know, I spelled everything out from the time I could remember up until, you know, I was in India, and I said, this is what you did and this is how I felt, and Pa, forgive me for feeling that way. It was nothing, again, it was nothing that my dad had. He didn't do anything wrong. It was just how I felt. And I sat there and I said, Pa, will you forgive me? And at this point, I'm like all crying and all everything. And my dad said, yeah, Kese, I forgive you. And it was as if a burden had been lifted off me. It was as if, you know, I never had a problem with my father. And I'm so glad that I did that, because not only, you know, a burden is lifted off you, it's also, I got to experience God as a father in a completely different way. See, when we have a good relationship with our earthly father, we are able to envision God, our heavenly father, far better. And if we can't experience our earthly father in a well way, you will not have that same, you will have difficulty trying to have a great image of God as your father. And once I did this, you know, we were talking and everything. About a week after that, I realized that my eczema had cleared off completely. And it was a very different kind of cleared off. Because when I had eczema, I was always on like steroid creams and just maintaining it. So many times when I apply a cream, the eczema will be gone for a couple of days. It will clear off completely, and then you'll come back again, you know. But, and you can feel it. It's just like if you have eye infection or something, you know whether it's completely gone or you know whether it's going to come back again. And for me, I felt like it was never going to come back again. It was such a, I didn't even have to use a cream. I didn't have to use, you know, any medication. It just went off like that. And I thank God for giving me the strength, you know, to forgive my father, and the obedience for me to do so. Because now, yeah, I do get rashes every once in a while, but it's never as bad as when I was. It's always because God uses it to me, lah. God uses me having rashes as a way of telling me that I need to check myself. So every time it comes back, I'm like, okay, let's check myself. But yeah, my testimony here today is because I just thank God for convicting me. And because of that, I can experience God's freedom physically. No longer I can eat whatever I want, you know. I can wear whatever I want, you know. It was very difficult for me to wear jeans, you know, just very, very simple things. So, yeah, I just want to praise and thank God for that, yeah.
So you can see that unforgiveness can result in physical ailments. In Cassandra's case, it was the eczema attack. Thirdly, unforgiveness can block God from answering our prayers. Unforgiveness. Cassandra shared just now that she prayed and prayed and prayed, but her prayers was not answered. Right? But when she begin to exercise forgiveness, the answer came. Amen? So, unforgiveness can cause our prayers not to be answered. It is that serious. Okay? And when you stand praying, Mark 11:25, if you hold anything against anyone, forgive them so that your Father in heaven may forgive you your sins. So you look at this verse, it says, when you stand praying, whatever prayer, your petitions, your requests, when you're bringing that to the Lord, if you have something against someone, God is telling us to make it right with that person so that your prayers will be answered. Are you with me? Yeah, amen? Okay, let's move on. Forgiveness opens us up to curses. Deuteronomy 27:26, it says, "Cursed is anyone who does not uphold the words of this law by carrying them out." So, one of God's commandments is to forgive one another. Amen? We need to forgive one another. And, you know, if we harbor unforgiveness, it oftentimes translates to some actions. It translates to some actions. And sometimes when it translates to some actions, we get a reaction from the other party. Are you with me? Huh? And sometimes that reaction from the other party can also be not pleasant. It can be in the form of curses. Okay? So, unforgiveness opens up. Okay? Opens us up to curses. Can we move on? And the final point here is unforgiveness prevents us from being fruitful spiritually. In John 15:5 and verse 10 to 12, it says, "I am the vine, you are the branches. If you remain in me and I in you, you will bear much fruit. Apart from me, you can do nothing. If you keep my commands, you will remain in my love, just as I have kept my Father's commands and remain in his love. I have told you this so that my joy may be in you and that your joy may be complete. My command is this, love each other as I have loved you." Amen? So God is telling us to love one another, and loving one another involves releasing forgiveness, okay? And when we do that, God's love remains in us, and when we remain in God, we bear fruit. Let's move on. So, who should we forgive? Okay, there are some things that are going to be mentioned today might be an eye-opener for some of us, okay? The people who hurt you long ago, as well as the stranger who cut abruptly into your lane this morning, okay? Everyone who has offended you. Sometimes, you know, you're coming to church some more. Suddenly, one guy zooms past by, and then he says, "What, love this guy?" And you go on and on. You know, in the evening also, you can't get over it. This guy, I hope he meets in an accident. You know, we say these kind of things, you know. But we need to release forgiveness as soon as possible. We need to release forgiveness as soon as possible, as well as those old hurts. Sometimes it's stacked up somewhere. Once in a while, it comes out and goes back. But I believe the Lord is going to speak to all of us today, okay? And He's going to reveal to you if there's any unforgiveness that needs to be dealt with, and He wants you to deal with it, not for that person's sake, but for your sake, so that we are not bound by all these consequences that we saw: unanswered prayers, sickness, curses, you know, all of these things, okay? Secondly, a dead person who may have hurt you before. You know, some people, they were offended by someone, and then that person has already died, but they are still so angry with that person. Have you met people like that? Yeah? Sometimes it's their father or grandfather or somebody. The father dead and gone 10 years, 15 years. "You know, my father was like that, you know, that's why I'm like this." They still keep, you know, I had a cousin brother many years ago. He's passed away now. He was a drug addict, and I remember talking to him, and he would always talk about his father. He would always talk bad about his father and say, "You know, my father was this, you know," trying to say that he's justified, that he's where he is because of his father. And he would always say that, even though his father had passed away for many, many years. Now this chap also passed away already. Okay, but what I'm telling you is, we need to release, even if it's somebody dead. It's not for that person's sake. It's for whose sake? Our sake. When you harbor that unforgiveness, you open the door for the evil one to come in and torment you. Are you with me? Yeah, okay. If you understand that, you would want to get unforgiveness out of the way as soon as possible. Are you with me? Okay. Okay, let's move on. Sometimes we need to forgive ourselves because we did something at the spur of the moment, and then we got so upset with ourselves and we are angry with ourselves, and we need to forgive ourselves too. All right, let's move on. Sometimes we need to forgive God. Wow. Maybe I should rephrase that. We think, or we are hurt, we say, we are upset, we are bitter with God because our lives didn't turn out the way we wanted it to. How come God allowed this to happen? How come God allowed this? That's why my life is today like this. You know? And if you are angry with God that way, you better ask God for forgiveness. You better release that forgiveness and ask God to forgive you. Okay? And finally, any organization, a company who may have mistreated you, you know, and organizations, companies sometimes, it's, who is in there? People. Am I right? So you may be upset with some company, but actually you're upset with some people there. And today, you know, with social media, it's very interesting, the articles that you read on social media. When people are angry, you can see how they comment on social media. And some people like to parade their private life in public. Do you know what I mean? They have an argument with a friend, they go to the internet, Facebook, and then they present and say, you know, this person should know better than doing this and that and that and this. You know, how could this person do this? You know, and hoping that somebody will ask, hey, what happened? What happened? Are you okay? You know? But chill, you know, relax. What's happened? Can you want me to call you? Shall we go out for a drink? You know, they like this kind of response. It's not going to help you in any way. By going public, you're going to make things worse. Are you with me? If you really want to solve the problem, go and deal directly with that person. Hard. Ask God to help you. We will talk about that. So, any organization or people who may have mistreated you, okay, we need to release. Now, I'm not saying when you forgive and release means you condone what they have done. It doesn't mean that what they did becomes okay. That's not what I'm saying. What I'm saying is you need to release that forgiveness so that you don't hold it against them. That anger, all that must subside. Are you with me? If somebody cheated you again and again, you forgive them. And I'm not saying go back and get cheated again. Do you understand what I'm saying? You have to be smart. The Bible tells us that we have to be smart. But you need to forgive them. But the next time, you'll be careful that he won't cheat you again. You understand? Right? But we need to forgive. Let's move on. So, how to forgive? Firstly, you need to decide to forgive. Now, the Bible verses that we won't be going in. You can write it down if you want. You can read it yourself, okay? We need to decide to forgive. So, you need to make a decision that I'm going to forgive this sister. I'm going to forgive my father. I'm going to forgive my mother. I'm going to forgive my brother or sister or auntie or uncle or dead uncle. Doesn't matter. You decide today, or your pastor, or Brother Robert Chalea, he did something to me last time. He said something offended me. Please forgive me today. All right? So we need to decide to forgive. Secondly, we need to depend on the Holy Spirit. If you read that scripture, John 20, verse 20 to 23, 20-23, Jesus Christ, after he had breathed the Holy Spirit upon them, he told them to forgive those who have offended them. Okay, the disciples. So you can read that. We need the Holy Spirit to help us to forgive. In times when you feel that you cannot forgive, it's so hard to forgive, ask the Holy Spirit to help you. He is our helper. Amen? Amen? You believe God's word? We need to put it into practice. A lot of people have God's word up here. They can get very involved in heavy theological discussions. But it's not here. It's not translating into their life. Are you with me? God's word must transform your life. You know, if it remains up here, you become very good in intellectual discussions and arguments, but your life doesn't show it. All right, let's move on. Pray for your enemies. Luke 6, verse 27 and 28. Okay, we need to pray for our enemies. Jesus Christ said that. Bless and do not curse. Bless and do not curse. You know, I'm not a Greek scholar, but I did some research, and it says, in the Greek, to bless means to speak well of. I repeat, it says in the Greek, to bless means to speak well of, and to curse means to speak evil of. So you can't walk in forgiveness and be a gossip. Amen? Wow, nobody say amen. Oh, whoa. You can't walk in forgiveness and be a gossip. Amen? Only the brother saying, huh? No, no. That's a bad joke. Huh? Okay. You must stop repeating the offense. You can't get over it if you continue to talk about it. So, you know, if you really forgive somebody, then one of the things that you need to stop is to replay that thing with your lips. Don't go and tell somebody the same story again and again. That means you still haven't forgotten. You know, as I'm preaching this message, preparing for this message, I felt so committed, so convicted. I had to make several prayers myself to the Lord. We are human beings, right? Amen? But the good thing is we don't stand being condemned. God provides a way for us. Amen? Praise the Lord. Let's move on. So, bless and do not curse. So, begin to speak well of them. If you really don't have anything nice to say, don't say anything. Instead of saying bad things about people. And 5, forgive quickly. In Ephesians chapter 4, verse 26 and 27, it says, in your anger, do not sin. Do not let the sun go down while you are still angry. And do not give the devil a foothold. Do not give the devil a foothold. Settle things quickly. You know, there was a time, you know, in the early years of our marriage, when I and my wife, we used to have some misunderstandings or quarrel or whatever you want to say. And then you know what happens? We give each other the silent treatment. Sometimes 2 or 3 days we don't talk. Oh, you're looking, oh, so many. I know, you're all in the same boat. Okay, but you know, during those times, it's very tense, isn't it? Why? Because, you know, one of the big problems is what? No, it's the big P. What's the big P? Pride. That is what most of the time holds us back from asking for forgiveness. Why should I ask forgiveness? She's the one who made mistake, what? She's the one who started the whole problem, what? Why should I ask for forgiveness? You understand? So we wait for her to respond. Or wait for him to respond. You understand what I'm saying? But in the meantime, while you're waiting, you are giving the devil a foothold. Are you with me? That is why the Bible says, before the sun goes down, go and settle it. Whether wife and husband, or father and son or daughter, whatever, you can settle it as soon as possible. Don't give the devil a foothold in your life. So, but over the years, you know, we have fine-tuned that, you know, and God began to work in our lives. So from the 3 hours, now it's become to like, I mean, from the 3 days, it's become to like 3 hours now. Okay? I mean, and we don't argue as often as we do, but off and on it does come up. We're all human beings, right? But when it does come, because the Holy Spirit convicts us both, so very quickly we begin to respond and we make it up. Amen? So there must be some improvement over. So 3 hours, make sure before the sun comes down. Settle it. Praise the Lord. So, and you know, in Matthew chapter 5, verse 21 to 24, it says, you have heard that it was said to the people long ago, you shall not murder, and anyone who murders will be subject to judgment. But I tell you that anyone who is angry with a brother or sister will be subject to judgment. Again, anyone who says to a brother or sister, Raka, in Aramaic it means worthless or empty-headed, is answerable to the court. And anyone who says, you fool, will be in danger of the fire of hell. Therefore, if you are offering your gift at the altar and there remember that your brother or sister has something against you, leave your gift there in front of the altar. First go and be reconciled to them. Then come and offer your gift. Amen? We need to deal with these things as soon as possible. Because if not, it will affect your prayers, it will affect your worship, it will affect your relationship with God. So, in conclusion, Forgiving is not an emotion. It is an action. Forgiving others is not an option. It is a command. Amen? It is a command in the Word of God. If you really want to experience breakthrough, then whatever the Holy Spirit convicts you, you need to act upon it. Amen? Let's move on. Christians have the strength from God to forgive. Sometimes with our own capability, we are unable to do. But with the help of the Holy Spirit, we are able to forgive. Next point, please. Jesus' great love for mankind was shown when he said, "Father, forgive them, for they don't know what they are doing." You know, at the end of the day, you know, no matter how angry we are, no matter what people have done to us, we need to look at the cross. Amen? When we look at the cross, when Jesus Christ was there, and on that path, you know, when he walked up, I think they call it the Via Dolorosa, all the way to where he was crucified, you know, he was slapped, he was hit on the head with the stick, and people spit on him. And they also blindfolded him at one point of time. They put a crown of thorns on his head. All this they did to Jesus Christ, who is the creator of the universe. And what did he say? Wait, I'll come and send you to hell. Did he say that? What did he say? Did he say payback time or something like that? He said, "Father, forgive them, for they don't know what they are doing." Or, "For Father, they know not what they do," is what Jesus Christ prayed. "Please forgive them." And Jesus Christ was teaching us something he practiced himself. We cannot say, "God, you don't understand what I'm going through." Sometimes we tell God, "God, you don't understand what I'm going through." Jesus Christ walked this earth for 33 years. And when he went to the cross, he can tell us, "You don't know what I went through on the cross." I don't think any one of us can imagine. He was crucified there, you know, almost naked, bleeding, spit all over his face. And he said, "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do." Now, if that doesn't convict us, I don't know what will. Can I just invite you to stand with me as we conclude in prayer? Can I have the worship team come, please?